Our world is becoming increasingly more complex and connected. For 95% of humanity's existence, we didn't even know about electricity. There is a fundamental physical law which states that energy cannot be created nor destroyed, but only transformed. In that sense, all the energy we currently use in our homes, communications, factories, among many other things, had not been created in a coal factory or in the desert with solar panels. The energy that humanity uses had always been transformed from a source, be it coal factories or in hydroelectric power plants that use kinetic energy from their turbines or in nuclear power plants. The world has a constantly growing need for energy as the world population increases to meet the needs of each and every one of us. So far, the easy solution had been to burn fossil fuels such as coal or oil, but this has taken a toll on the planet. These resources are finite and are rapidly declining. So what solution has been proposed to face the inevitable energy crisis? The answer isn't so simple, since it is a matter in which politicians, economists, and above all scientists have been debating for a long time. However, time is running out, and it is critical that we find another sustainable and perpetual source of energy. Fortunately, we are coming close to a semi-perpetual source. Let's begin. The Earth. A floating blue sphere in the middle of an endless vacuum. This blue marble contains life thanks to a combination of key factors. But the most important is the heat and energy produced by our sun, our source of life. It is the main factor responsible for our plants to germinate, and it is the reason why our oceans contain life, and what maintains the world's food cycle. However, the world currently uses most of its energy thanks to the burning of fossil fuels. Currently, oil is the most important source of energy for society, being responsible for 33% of the energy obtained, followed by carbon with 24%, gas with 22%, and the rest of renewable energies and nuclear energy only make up 15%. In a world with a limited source of oil, extracting 40 million barrels of oil per day or more is clearly not sustainable. Even if other potential oil reserves were found, this would only end up damaging the environment in the long term. It is even estimated that oil will run out in about 40 years. Gas isn't sustainable either. Even if Russia has the largest gas reserves in the world, at the current rate of extraction, we will run out of gas in just 160 years. Even the abundant carbon, one of the basic elements of the universe, is not unlimited on our planet. But carbon is not eternal, and with the current rate of consumption, it will only last another 400 years. This may seem like a long time to us, but in the scale of the history of humanity, it's practically nothing. So to ensure the continuity of our species, society, and civilization, monumental efforts have been made in order to transform our economies from being fossil fuel addicts into economies that consume clean and sustainable sources of energy. For a few years now, European countries have been developing strategies to increase infrastructure to free themselves from fossil fuels. And although now, for example, there are countries such as Sweden and Denmark that produce more than half of their energy from renewable sources, there are other nations such as China, the US, or Poland that still depend on burning coal to power their cities. Other countries, such as France, for example, depend heavily on nuclear energy. Powering an entire country, such as the United States, solely with solar and wind power would require an enormous scale of construction of solar panels extending through practically all the deserts of the country. Although this is technically possible, redistributing the energy throughout the whole country is another story. So we can see the practicality of oil and gas. They can be stored and later burned to generate electricity when needed. In the case of solar panels, the energy produced by sunlight is instantaneously converted into electricity. If it isn't used immediately, it can still be stored in batteries, but applying this to such a massive country can prove to be quite problematic. Theoretically, solar energy could be enough to cover all our energy needs as a civilization. So how can we turn this into a reality? Take for example the most famous desert in the world, the Sahara. This desert covers multiple countries in North Africa, extending over 9 million square kilometers. The Sahara Desert receives countless hours of sunlight per year. So could the Sahara supply our entire energy demand? Theoretically, yes. If we only covered 1.2% of the Sahara Desert in photovoltaic panels, we would be talking about an approximate 100,000 square kilometers covered in solar panels. These panels could generate enough energy to cover the entire global demand. The engineering challenge would be the development of a system capable of storing and distributing all this energy to Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Americas. Africa does not have very good electrical networks, and new infrastructure capable of transporting this energy over long distances would be needed. So what would be the geopolitical and economic risk of concentrating all the world's production in this one region? not to mention the engineering and economic complications that must be solved to carry out this project in the first place. Another solution could be the widespread use of nuclear energy. After the atomic bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945, it was demonstrated that the power of the atom could either lead humanity to its salvation or its destruction. The truth is that decades of research by scientists ended with the construction of nuclear power plants around the world, which are mostly water-based nuclear power plants. Inside a container, the nuclear fission is produced, which separates the heavy atoms such as uranium, while neutrons are being bombarded. Therefore, the atoms are separated, which produces a controlled chain reaction, which produces heat, which then boils and evaporates the water, which then drives a turbine. Nuclear power became more widespread after the oil crash of 1983, when oil prices increased disproportionately after the embargo of the OPEC countries. More than half of nuclear reactors were built during this time. Millions of scientists and politicians were convinced that nuclear power would be the solution to all our energy problems, but we quickly realized that the physics and engineering was not so easy to translate from blueprint to reality. And above all, it was very, very expensive. A couple nuclear disasters, such as Chernobyl and Fukushima, to close nuclear power plants throughout the world, and the government should focus above all to develop solar and wind energy. And although there are still countries, especially emerging countries, that continue to build nuclear power plants, other countries such as Germany, Japan, and France are beginning to renounce nuclear power. Recently, China, which is the number one polluted country in the world, has taken on the role of being a leader in the construction and development of clean and renewable energy. Currently, the situation in the country is dire, where, for example, in the capital Beijing, breathing the air for one day is equivalent to smoking 20 cigarettes. A while ago, China made rounds in world news because it managed to create an artificial sun that managed to acquire a temperature of 100 million degrees Celsius, enough to generate nuclear fusion. Fusion and nuclear fission are two different things. Fusion is, for example, the engine of our sun. It is the same process that makes all the stars in the cosmos shine. And the principle is that under great pressures and temperatures, it is possible to fuse atoms that would normally repel each other, generating atomic quantities of energy. Fission, on the other hand, is the inverse. It is the separation of atoms. In order to not complicate matters, for a long time, scientists have been trying to imitate the same atomic process that our sun performs in experiments here on Earth. But in order to do this, we must create conditions similar to our star. In other words, emulate a mini sun capable of achieving nuclear fusion, capable of generating electricity for everyone. Nuclear fusion does not produce any radioactive waste. If the scientific community can fully develop nuclear fusion, we will have unlocked access to a clean and almost infinite source of energy. The Chinese experiment was also a statement to the world that China is trying to lead efforts to solve the nuclear fusion puzzle, but it is not the only country. These advances will contribute to the construction of the International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, a project developed in the south of France, where 35 countries will collaborate, including China, the US, Russia, and the EU. The objective of this project is to achieve in some way the same reaction that takes place within the heart of our sun. But at the moment, they are just experiments. And although it has been possible to carry out the fusion in small lapses of time, for the moment it costs more to carry out all the experiments than the energy actually produced by the fusion. There are still decades before it is commercially viable, and perhaps it will never be. The problem is, we may never really reach the point of imitating the conditions present in our sun here on Earth. So for the moment, while some countries led by presidents like Trump that refuse to transition to other sources of energy are committing to not develop their technology in order to allow humanity to free itself from dependence on oil and other fossil fuels, continuing to burn coal can be a simple and short-term solution, but they are risking the availability of energy in the coming years. Currently, there is a very interesting concept called the Kardashev scale. It visualizes the level of development of a civilization based on the energy that it can harness. A Type 1 civilization, for example, would have the capacity to collect all the energy from its native planet. So us humans aren't even a Type 1 civilization yet. We're estimated to be only at 0.73. A much more advanced civilization could evolve into a Type 2 civilization, with the potential to collect the energy of its host star. How could that be possible? Well, theoretically, they could develop gargantuan solar panels that would encase their star to capture all of its potential energy. And finally, a Type 3 civilization would be able to harness the entire energy of its host galaxy. But we are millions of years away from reaching this potential. So all in all, our planet's resources are finite. But in a couple centuries, we may reach the status of a Type 1 civilization. We will then be forced to look for alternative forms of energy. So what do you think about the incoming energy crisis? Do you think we should focus more on renewable energy sources, or should we risk a little more to achieve nuclear fusion that could potentially completely solve this issue? So I hope you enjoyed this video, and don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't already. See you next time.